Today, I'm going to talk about the working of information ethics of human rights in academia. Beijing's editing techniques for ethics professionals has revolutionized scientific research. It's a biological cut and paste tool derived from the microbial adaptive immune system. It works by finding target sites by DNA RNA in helium and then using microcytes to sniff the site, either leaking, repelling, or replacing the affected gene. Yeah, it has been only 5 years since Cas9 was discovered or invented, but the technology has proven to be powerful. In addition to being widely used in clinical trials such as regulation of the transcription or in vitro chromosome imaging, somatic cell gene therapies with mutation gene infection, germline gene infection to prevent inborn genetic disorder, transgenome modification without introduction of foreign genes, extinction of disease vectors from invasive species, and the resurrection of extinct animals. On the other hand, this powerful technique, however, can lead to adverse effects due to immature clinical applications, enhancement of human genes rather than therapeutic purposes, regulatory escape of gene-edited plants, and ecosystem destruction. In particular, what confuses us most is the controversial modification of human embryos. 7 embryos on germline gene editing were conducted so far. Let me introduce several cases. First case, in April 2015, when the public opinion that human embryos should not be edited allowed, Jinju Fang, a researcher at Sun Yat-sen University in Guangzhou, China, attempted to edit germ cells for human embryos in a world first. To avoid the accusation of violating ethical lines, they used 3 pro-nuclear zygotes for experiments. The team's goal was to successfully repair a beta globin gene that caused the fetal blood disease known as beta thalassemia. As Fang himself admitted, the research was not so successful. The 71 embryos survived by applying CRISPR-Cas9 to 86 embryos. 54 was examined, 28 of which were successfully spliced, only 4 of which had the intended to replace genes. Furthermore, even these embryos through the mosaicism mixed with the modified cells and the non-modified cells, off-target mutations were also observed. However, the researchers acknowledged that the low efficiency and high number of off-target mutations could be specific to abnormal embryos used in this study. The researchers also added that the reliability and the specificity of the technology should be further improved. Judging from these findings, the clinical applications of this technology ought to be commercial. That's in the second case. In May 2016, a team of researchers at Guangzhou Medical University in China conducted a proof of principle test to determine if genetically modified early embryos could be genetically modified using CRISPR-Cas9. The CCR5 beta 32 allele, which naturally occurs in 213 human triploid zygotes was introduced by injecting a CRISPR-Cas9 clones containing two types of guide RNA. In the control group, 72% of the zygotes were injected with the CRISPR-Cas9 and the 64 and 62% of the zygotes developed into the 8 to 16 cells. Of the total 26 embryos, 4 embryos were found containing CCL5 delta 32. 3 of the 4 embryos showed the mosaicism. Though 20 potential off-target sites were investigated in 3 embryos containing the CCL5 delta 32 allele, no indel was observed. Third case. In March this year, the Guangzhou University research team in China first tried to investigate the success rate of gene editing by applying the CRISPR-Cas9 on human normal embryos. On human normal embryos. A male sperm with genetic disease were injected with the CRISPR-Cas9 in the normal oocyte per division to make 6 embryos. In the production experiment of G1376T mutated the G6PD gene using 2 embryos, both were collected, but one of them showed mosaicism. In the production experiment of beta 41 to beta 42 mutated beta thalassemia gene using 4 embryos, one embryo showed the mosaicism and the other 3 failed. The number of embryos used in study was so small that they could not make any different conclusion. First case. After treatment of CRISPR-Cas9, repair deficiencies were reported as low as 2% in peripheral human embryonic stem cells and 13 to 25% in human embryos. Italicop and Injinsu collaborated on the creating of human embryo genes. This experiment used normal embryos and introduced CRISPR-Cas9 components at the time of fertilization and did not show any off-target effects and mosaicism appeared in the previous study. The research involved eggs from 12 healthy female donors and sperm from a male volunteer who carries the MYBPC3 gene, which causes hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. The yield of collected embryos in the metastatic phase injected group was significantly higher than in untreated control, affecting the probability of having a normal copy is about 25% higher. The remaining 16 embryos showed the indel formation in addition to repairable MYBPC3 copies. Almost all embryos with MYBPC3 were repaired with a maternal copy rather than an externally introduced template. Similar to the control embryo, 15% of the genetically modified embryo reached the last persist state, confirming normal development after editing. But now the integrity of this research is being challenged. Fifth case. On September of this year, Ji Jiang Chen attempted to edit 3 pronuclear embryos using a single base editing method, which is far different from the conventional method of gene editing. Using the BEC3 base editor, the target site of beta thalassemia gene in 8 of 19 embryos was reported to be modified. 7 embryos were modified in the A base with the G base and C base with the pig or pigs in one embryo. Using the SAKKH, these three editing tools, the target region of the FUNK gene has been modified in all 17 embryos. In 10 of them, the C base was modified to T base, and the other 7 C base was modified to A per G base. By this base editor, the target site of the GNMT3B gene was modified in 6 out of the 9 embryos. 3 of them were modified into C base with T base and C base with A per G base, respectively. This study demonstrates the possibility to make precise editing through single base modification in human embryos. Sixth case. On September of this year, the Niakan group announced their result by knocking out POU5F1 gene, including the universal transcription factor OCD4 during human normal embryo development. The blastocyst was not well developed. They double regulate the universal ectodermal regulator such as NANO, as well as the exogenous gene of the embryo such as CDX2, which is different from the result previously observed in mice. This Cas9 was thought to be helpful for human embryonic development. Seventh case. On September of this year, Hwang's group of Sun Yat-sen University, the first human germline gene editing researchers, again edit the human embryos at this time using base editor. Among the beta thalassemia, the HBV28A2G mutations, which frequently occurs in China and Southeast Asia, was edited by CRISPR-Cas9, and the efficiency of the gene editing was measured. In other mutated embryos, the researchers conducted the nuclear transfer embryos by fusing the lymphocyte or skin fibroblast cells with the manipulated in vitro sites, and the infection efficiency of the base editor was found to be over 20%. More than 20% of the embryos developed with blastocyst. The researchers acknowledged the possibility of fixing genetic disorders in embryos by base editing method. These seven results can be summarized in the following paper. Yeah, the research started giving at the beginning of 2015. It was experimented with ball frequency. Developing methods. There is a sharp divide of regulation between the countries and between the researchers. In my opinion, the time is right to gradually transition from urban to partial prohibition. We are moving from the urban to partial prohibition of germline editing because many researchers already have done germline gene editing research since 2015. There is a pacing problem. Well, regulation is lagging behind development. The time has come to experiment on human gene lines their editing to be properly regulated. Now I want to analyze each case of the human online and based on the degree of accessibility. Reporting this, I have drawn metrics in sequence according to accessibility. From line cells, the three chrome nuclear zygotes have one good side nucleus and two strong nuclei. polysomic gyros such as this occur naturally in 2% to 5% of the zygotes during in vitro fertilization in clinical trials. Usually these zygotes invariably fail to develop normally in vivo, so they are not considered to be viable for implantation. They will develop a live baby. The use of non-viable pro-3 nuclear zygotes is the least problematic and more acceptable compared to the use of normal viable embryos. You can see the non-viable zygotes and the other embryos. Many legislation systems, including Korea, allow the use of leftover embryos, but instead inhibit the production of new embryos. This reflects the fact that the production of new embryos for experiment is probably more problematic than use of leftover embryos. Boundary of forces. Though the boundaries of proposals are somewhat blurred, I deliberately incorporate these proposals such as therapeutic based science, proof of principle, and then consent. The therapeutic research is a study of mitigating and eliminating inborn disorders directly by gene correction. By definition, the basic research is a study of developmental or physiological products that result from gene editing. The principle of so-called principle research is a study to determine whether CRISPR-Cas9 works well in human embryos, whether there is any off-target effect on mosaicism, and how to improve precision and efficiency technically. Enhancement research is a study for genetic modification used to improve traits for post-adult therapy. Analysis. Using developed metrics, I try to categorize the existing 7 experiments based on the possibility of ethical acceptance. Though it posed a fierce controversy, the first experiment by BNL could be judged to be ethically the least problematic compared to the other experiments. The first experiment with non-viable zygotes and for although the target genes are different, the second experiment is also similar to the first. We can improve the disorder by base pairing using non-viable feed from the genes. This seems to come from the left gene editing method and the fixed experiments are from the single base editing method. So doing the principle of a provable principle experiment with non-viable embryos or animal embryos is ethical more compelling than with viable embryos. The seventh experiment is a little unusual. Instead of using 3 pro-nuclear zygotes or embryos, constructed embryos from somatic cells or insulin. The moral status of these embryos are not certain. It requires a long discussion for the moral status of these embryos, but for convenience, it is placed between the leftover embryos and produced embryos. I think the research conducted by the type of case boasted it highly probable that it was the produced embryos for research. Even compared to the study experiment, it is more problematic because the error used 131 embryos, the former used only 6 embryos. Acknowledging this, they are trying to give the impression that this experiment has been conducted for therapeutic purposes to more ethical people in the world. Can we justify these experiments? We have to experiment with the embryos. In case the ball is compelling, it will be justified to use the embryo for experiment. The use of the embryos for therapeutic purposes can be considered to be more acceptable than for humanitarian business. Contrast to this, the use of embryos for enhancement purposes should be the least acceptable. However, in some cases, it is hard to tell therapy from enhancement. In therapeutic research and enhancement studies, it is difficult to experiment with non-viable embryos because a fully developed embryo is needed. Basic science can sometimes be experimented with non-viable, but if developmental patterns are different from those of other animals, experimentation with a viable embryo will be acceptable. Approval of clinical studies are more varied than enhancement studies, but less valid than basic studies. Metrics to regulation. Firstly, the genome editing purposes are categorized as therapeutic, basic science, proof of principle, and enhancement. From top to bottom, the purposes may potentially increase the regulatory relevance. Even those who advocate germline treatment, the other purposes such as enhancement could treat differently from a could be positive differently from a regulatory viewpoint. Secondly, germline cells were subdivided in order to map these embryos according to their regulatory levels. Using leftover embryos for research is considered to be less problematic and thus less subject to the regulations than making new embryos for research. Some legislation system allowing the use of the surplus embryos while limiting embryo production for experimenting affect this concept. Concluding the law, I propose that the regulation bodies should consider introducing regulation standards, drawing the line between the cells of the matrix. For third purposes, we can be considering moving the line, like what if the technical difficulties are sufficiently resolved, the benefits outweigh the risk. Such a cautious approach would contribute to harmonizing countries that show regulatory divide on germline editing. In the gene editing era, the medical practices developed by advanced gene editing is not hampered by technological aspects only, but by its understanding and the acceptance of such technologies in society. Researchers, the public, and the regulatory bodies should discuss socially acceptable interaction with Gemini machine. And I hope this kind of mistakes can help resolve the regulatory challenges. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there any question? Yes, please.
Thank you very much for your very good presentation and very important information which I get. Many years ago, I have worked with beta thalassemic patients, so with which diseases is very dispersed in our region, and it's mean the Mediterranean or malaria zone, you know. And to the children with the homozygote forms of beta thalassemia, they could not survive for more than 15 years, and during the a lot of the blood transfusion, the damage to the organs was very high. So my question is, what do you think as a scientist? Is it the new gene editing technology will be very useful to solve these problems with a very, important severe heredity diseases? Thank you.
I said that traffic research is more important than the base science for the systems for the enhancement. So if one suffers from a newborn disorder, we can draw the line like this. Yeah. We did left over a year for test research, but trying this using left over a year for basic science or football, physical and but it is so that most of all, the seven experiments are for football, physical research using even and we put this for so I think it is important to draw the line between these cells whether we can commit or prohibit the use of the embryos for the experiment.
Please.
Yeah. Don't ask too much.
Thank you, Vicky, for your nice presentation and for making good presentation. Actually, my question is each country has the regulation for moral status of the embryo, and I like to know that what is you have shown that the research is doing on leftover embryo, and I like to know that what is the moral status of the embryo in your country? What is your country position on the moral status of the embryo?
Yeah, thank you. In Korea, we committed in special cases for using leftover embryos for research for incurable disease. And but in Korea, the researchers who saw this and they were researching should be passive. So I think there is a sharp divide between the using leftover embryos and individual purpose for research. Yeah. We don't have a law on the gene editing, but we have a stem cell law. So yeah, we have a sharp divide between these.
Okay, thank you very much. And last question. Okay.
Thank you, Professor. It's a very good presentation, very impressive. And I know you just summarized the 7 articles to categorize all these the aspects of the what we call the editing genome, germline editing, and science. So I have a question, because this is a lot of problem of how you categorize, but you know the barrier from the viable zygote to be a live baby is not so difficult. So how can we make the measure of that to make a very, very strict regulation on that? Otherwise, there will be a slippery slope. That will cause a very a serious consequence. So I would like, how could we make such a regulatory measure on that? Because the barrier between the non-viables either left over embryo to the leaf baby is possible. Is the barrier is very, very low, yes, compared to the germline editing and slicing technique, yes.
Joseph,
I already
told that boundaries between these proportions are somewhat broad. So, though I draw the sharp line between therapeutic and genetic science, in fact, there is no such line, I think. Yeah, so, researchers doing genetic science sometimes say that we are doing therapeutic research instead of big science research or cultural transfer research. And also, there are not sharp divide between therapeutic research and enhancement research. Okay, we can make the people living without any disease. Yeah, it's good. But how about the following? It's a disorder or just beauty for men to live? Or, yeah, let's think about aging. It is a disorder or, yeah, to live longer with enhancement or therapy. I think we don't have this strict distinction between these opposites, but we have to make, we are trying to make more discussions and surveillance of the experiment. I hope we can make distinction between these opposites. Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for your presentation. Yeah, let's start.